What exactly do we mean by time? Is this a physical measurement, a metaphysical construct, or merely a lived psychic phenomenon? In this lecture, I'd like to talk about the presence of intrapsychic reality that corresponds to experiences of the temporal. For anything to be perceived or experienced in time, it must be psychologically mediated. And this necessarily involves unconscious processes that operate on an affective level. When affective states make their way into consciousness, we typically identify the experience in them as emotions. Here I particularly want to explore the emotion of shame in the clinical encounter. The relationship between the analyst's shame and the phenomenon of temporality casts a particular light on the quality of the lived experience that occurs in treatment. As the relational encounter unfolds in the intrasubjective field, psychic reality traverses the whole gamut and continuum of time that springs from the archaic primacy of the past, the immediational presence of the current moment, and the projective teleology of the future as dialectical mediation. Temporal mediacy informs the qualitative experience of lived time in its simultaneous reiteration of the past within the present and the future trajectory of consciousness, hence re-presencing mnemonic linkages to affect states and emotional schemata that are stimulated by the therapeutic environment. When the experience of shame is evoked in the analyst or a therapist, it is linked to a reiteration of the temporal that stands in relation to the analyst's own developmental history within the current transference-countertransference dynamic. Shame may take on polarities in their manifestation, qualia, and vectors from the realm of pure negativity to that of ideality. Therapeutically, the clinician may be temporally surprised by the mobilization of shame to the point that it affects praxis and the treatment frame, hence altering the course and boundaries of the therapeutic process. What becomes more difficult to shoulder is an almost unbearable intensity of emotion that is usually enacted in the countertransference because the therapist feels it would be inappropriate to share such emotions directly with the patient. Shame is also structurally instituted by the very nature of the analytic milieu, where formal parameters of professional space impose a certain constraint on what the clinician and the patient can do, despite the fact that analysis by definition imposes the ethic of honesty on the subject. Here, disclosure becomes asymmetrical from the beginning, as does the seduction of the transference predicated on the therapeutic framework itself. For the patient is led to idealize and devalue the analyst at different temporal intervals in the treatment. We may say that shame is always in the background as unconscious presence, but also in the foreground as the realization that we can never fulfill the patient's desires or expectations, while at the same time holding back revelations that are deeply personal and confessional. These conditional dynamics maintain an artificial and/or constricted ambience that at times can appear very unnatural, inauthentic, and depriving to both parties involved. Therefore, shame is inscribed in the very ontostructural socio-symbolic matrix that constitutes the analytic encounter. In this lecture, I discuss the horrid conscription of shame after being idealized by a client who revered me as Jesus. A mutual shame dynamic resonated within the treatment due to the patient's own developmental traumas and my privately held atheism. My inner negotiation of shame led to interventions in the transference that centered on containment and role responsiveness. The treatment led to a creative transcendent function for both of us when I was able to transform historical shame by adopting the intentional stance of the other's idealization. In other words, by adopting the role my patient needed me to play in the idealized transference, shame was transmuted. When psychoanalysts speak of shame, it's usually in the context of critical superego functions, group identifications, idealizations, and idealized imagos, mobilization of defense and rage, narcissistic vulnerabilities connected to fragile, grandiose, or incohesive self states, hypocrisy, dissociation, inauthenticity, and morally corrupt agency, or based on insidious toxic interjects that hinder healthy personality structure, self-regulation, and disfigure attachment capacities due to developmental trauma. As the underside of narcissism, shame has traditionally been viewed as a negative, emotional qualitative form of psychic injury, what more contemporary discourse refers to as microtrauma. In considering shame as painful affect states or introjects that assault the integrity of the self and one's self-representations, there are innumerable forms shame can manifest with regard to content, form, scope, intensity, duration, and qualia. It is in fact the qualia of shame, those qualitative properties and emotional resonance contours that often give lived phenomenal experience their harrowing character. One decisive experience of shame is psychological exposure. That is, how certain aspects of oneself are disclosed, unconcealed, and viewed, hence judged by another. Such soul exposure, if we want to call it that, is colored by a certain degree of vulnerability, fear, lack of safety, embarrassment, hurt pride, humiliation, and so forth, which evokes feelings of inferiority, abnegation, psychic castration, and self-defect that are elicited, unwelcomed, exploited, and/or foisted upon us outside of our control. I would refer to this as imposed shame, and there's almost always an element of surprise involved, for events sprung on us without anticipation, preparation, or warning are experienced as encroachments to our psychic integrity. While we also displace, externalize, and project disowned shame experiences onto others, as seen in childhood onward, shame is ultimately an intimate self-relation to one's interior, mediated by many competing psychological dynamics, contexts, and contingencies. This makes the experience of shame a highly esoteric enterprise, despite the fact that it is a universal emotion derived from interpsychic conditions that are interpersonally informed. Shame arises when we can't live up to our own ideals. But shame is much more than that. Shame is the emotive corollary of self-consciousness as the recognition of one's failure to live up to one's own self-imposed ideals that bring about self-condemnation and narcissistic depletion. Despite the fact that ideals and values are based on the internalization of one's identifications with one's parents, community, society, culture, and so on, we develop a very intimate relationship with our values as they form the qualitative bedrock of our own self-relation to self-valuation, vulnerable to judgment and criticism from others. Shame, I suggest, is ultimately based in negation, the compromise or devolution of self-value. When you betray your own self-professed values, you sully the self, and hence shame is a logical consequence of self-abnegation as recognition of lack, and in particular, a lack of courage to live up to ideality. As an assault on self-consciousness, shame becomes amplified when one lacks cognizance or knowledge of themselves. I would refer to this as epistemological shame. One instance of this is bearing witness to the other's acute awareness and observation of some absence, failure, or deficit in oneself. Perhaps this is a more intense form of shame because others see your vulnerabilities and weaknesses, and you are now forced to become aware of the other's knowledge of how they see something in you that you did not notice before. Here, shame is a lack of self-knowledge given over to us by the mirror image of the other's epistemology. In other words, when others see things we do not see in ourselves, shame is a fortiori inevitable. And more ironically, the analytic arrangement is set up to be where the analyst is supposed to be the one who knows, hence a master discourse. But looking at shame as an internal self-relation of failing to live up to ideals is a private inner experience clouded in negative feelings that affects the self-esteem of the subject. It's shrouded in avoidance, annulment, dissociation, and denial. I propose that the qualitative felt injury of exposure is an important aspect affecting the degree and intensity of experiential shame, whether a self-exposure, for instance, a self-conscious awareness of one's own personal limitations and ignorance, or more sinisterly, when others mock, ridicule, denounce, or reject you, especially when there are perceptual acts of humiliation cast upon the subject. Feeling out of control over the affair only accentuates emotive self-derision. Acts of aspersion that are public and witnessed by others are most poignant and emotionally agonizing to anyone. Yet shame is always an internal relation, regardless of what others do or say. It is always mine. Either you experience it or not. Here, the quality of mindness is always an internal self-relation to one's interior. Time, or to be more precise, temporality as living time, is also indispensable for shame to occur, even when it involves conjuring historical memory or its re-inscribed after effects, because it is temporally mediated in the present, hence confronting the residue or resurfacing of dishonor felt as tarnished desire and pride. Despite the fact that shame is memorialized in the psyche, that is, engraved as a negative mnemonic, leaving semiotic traces as reminders or recollections of the subject's vulnerability, which occurred in the past, it further elicits an impending realization that nothing can be done now, nor in the future, to remedy those adverse conditions or emotions tied to archaic events. It must merely be accepted and subsumed into history. When we fail to live up to an ideal, what we utmost value and prize, we are forlorn and left in the ashes of disappointment, weakened, crushed, maimed. Here I am reminded of Hegel's beautiful soul as a divided self. Spirit or Geist is aware of what it wants and what is right, but it just can't live up to its own values. Instead, sadly, it is interned in an unhappy consciousness. In this sense, shame always remains a condemned relation toward the future, as it can never be overcome or surpassed, hence sublated, only forgotten. Here shame is tied to some element of failed perfection, the notion that we can never be or become that ideal, whether in fantasy or reality, itself an artifice based in a fantasy principle. We remain exposed and exploited by our own limitations and must bear witness to our own imperfections, something that can only be mourned. The ego ideal is therefore an illusion. The ontological conditions of shame apply to everyone, including the clinical practitioner. What I have in mind is to articulate some parameters of the analysts bearing witness to their own shame in professional space, namely the consulting room, visited by the unwanted imposition of the alien other, an unconscious remainder of the real. But before venturing into case material, it becomes important to delineate our conceptuality of the temple. Time is a succession of phases experienced through our river of consciousness, a patterned fluidity of perishing awareness that contains the coming into being and passing away into nothing of its previous series of moments, what we may call phenomenal diachronies of a difference and change within a transmuting process of persistence. There are beginnings and endings, openings and closings, both ephemeral yet permanent. Time is pure flow and unrest, at once continuous yet spontaneous and fleeting, for as soon as you try to pin it down, it's already gone. Each moment is merely a transitory conduit to a new movement or mode of experience within an interconnected chain of moments containing past, present, and future, not to mention their gradations of closest to farthest, undiscernible to palpable in their sequence, all standing in dynamic relation to one another as a pressurized, holistic systemic. Yet there is a universality to time that is ontologically invariant as sheer process. Experience is imbued with diachronies that punctuate the pervasiveness of lived time, the essence of what precipitates shame. The diachronic experience of time is that there is a sensation of interruption with ordinary sequential time. It could be that lived time is experienced as long when it's short, minimal when it's qualitatively enduring, fleeting when it's protracted or unaccounted for, such as a depersonalized loss of time when one is in a state of psychogenic fugue, meditation, or mystical absorption. Here, time is both instituted and constituted in the moment of our living experience as we live it, which may entail a felt adjournment of consciousness as withering streams of awareness, or conversely, an attunement and intensity of self-consciousness as heightened self-reflexivity that directs our focus of awareness to a particularized moment of lived experience. While pondering the infinite, Husserl discovered the double continuity of time consciousness that apprehends the presence of the past and the future in the immediate present moment of awareness as an intentional act of relating to meant objects. Husserl theorized that the origin of subjective experience sprang from an originating or generative center in which all appearances arise, and that each moment is its own center responsible for engendering time. In the Phenomenology of Internal Time Consciousness, Husserl referred to this center as, quote, a point of actuality primal source point, end quote, in which time generates itself, that from which springs the now. Each present moment is held together by its simultaneous relation to the past and the future as a doubly continuous instant preserved in dialectical continuity. The double continuity of new presence, of the bipolar reiteration of itself, and in every fresh moment of experience, ensures that the continuously new presence of the now becomes the ground of all appearances. Our subjectivity of time always corresponds to a new now, whether one is reflecting on the past, the present, or an imagined or anticipated future state that has not actually occurred. Our attunement to presence involves a lived sense of passing and enduring within our moment-to-moment awareness of meant objects, which is both an act of transcendence and immanence. For Husserl, the ego or consciousness is a transcendental structure that generates forms of subjectivity in and through time, where there is no formal division of subject from object. Here, subject and object, self and world, are conjoined as a whole or superordinate totality, only separated by moments, hence abnegating the vicious bifurcation between nature and mind. It is in the bracketed act of epoche, or reduction, that reveals the world as a correlate of consciousness, which is performed by the pre-reflective transcendental ego. So when Husserl speaks of time as instantaneously transcendent and immanent, he's also speaking of the psyche in general. That which is given to consciousness is as much a transcendent objectivity as it is subjectively constituted. The feeling or thought of something beyond us is, or in abundance of us, that is temporally present in our immediate lived experience is a form of transcendence, as is the notion of anticipating the coming to presence or innateness of that experience arising in us. Time is not merely a theoretical abstraction, for we feel its presence, its comings and going, that which is momentarily here, then gone, only to be cyclically present as a dialectic of passing over into a ceasing to be, only to enter into a new movement of becoming that is retained through enduring experience encountered as transient intervals of length and intensity. At the same time, we may view time as an incorporeal condition, an immateriality of pure event, namely experience itself. Yet experience is a temporal embodiment. On the one hand, time is not an entity, literally no thing, and in this sense, immaterial. Yet on the other, it exists as actuality, governed by natural laws of pattern continuity, duration, perishing, and succession, as a flux of appearing modes of becoming. Time is always coming, going, and is here, hence developing, transitioning, succumbing, and expiring, yet never fully ceasing, as it is born anew as an eternal presence and recurrence within an ordered series of temporal modalities and periods. Paradoxically, we may even say there is no such thing as pure time independent of mind, as it's merely a formal concept. Rather, time is constituted through embodied space. Hence, its appearance is always enmattered, yet nowhere to be seen. To be more specific, because mind is embodied activity, temporal experience is only possible through cognition. And here the notion of time takes on its own phenomenal encounters. Time is neither static nor fixed, nor is it a tangible thing that can be appropriated, for it's invisible and indivisible, yet it transpires in a series of spacings each of us inhabit in our mental and material worlds. And this is why it is more appropriate to think of our experiential relation to space-time as a fused event. Here the essence of time is process. Our relationship to presence and absence, finitude and eternity, flux and permanence, all presuppose our intimate dynamic relation to what I call temporal mediacy. Here time draws on the archaic primacy of our past as the amalgamation of our historicities, our ontological preconditions, and developmental trajectories. The immediational presence of the phenomenology of our present concrete and qualitatively lived experience as mediated immediacy, and projective teleology of the imagined future as a valued ideal, goal, or purposive aim. These three simultaneous facets of temporal mediacy are operative at any given moment in psychic tandem, where the past and future convene on the present or immediate subjective experience. The presentational encounters of past, present, and future we confront as immediacy become our metaphysical relation to time, albeit phenomenologically realized in the here and now. Psychic organization has a simultaneous temporal relation to the past, the present, and the future. One, the past is subsumed and preserved within the psyche. Two, the present is immediate, mediated experience. And three, the future, in contemplation and fantasy, becomes a motivational teleological impetus. Temporal experience is a mediational realization informed by the threefold relation of the dialectic. However, each domain may have competing and or opposing pressures that affect the other modalities at any given moment. In other words, each locus may pressurize, extol, invade, usurp, coalesce, and or symbiotically conjoin with others within their interdependent dynamic system. But each domain also has the potential to have a subjective surge, voice, or lived reality of its own, despite the force and presence of the other two realms. Yet such seemingly autonomous moments of individualized expression are relegated to the broader systemic processes that operate within the dialectical mind. In psychoanalytic language, we may refer to these differentiated experiences as a multiplicity of self-states that are operative on parallel or overdetermined levels of functioning within the ontologically monistic supraordinate agency we call the self. The past we may refer to as archaic primacy, thus emphasizing the primordial nature of our historicities, including a priori ontological conditions, for example, constitutional, social, and cultural forces, as well as that which is subjectively, that is, qualitatively, and developmentally experienced, both consciously and unconsciously. Here we may say this is archetypal, for history always re-enters psychic structure. The present we may call immediate presence, thus stressing the phenomenology of the concretely lived experience presented as subjectively mediated immediacy. And the future we describe in terms of projective teleology, which captures the future trajectory of the dialectic of desire, which stands in relation to a valued ideal, goal, purpose of action, or wish fulfillment. These three simultaneous facets of temporal immediacy are the dialectic in action in the moment of bringing the past and future to bear upon its present or immediate experience. Archaic primacy holds a privileged position in the psyche, since the mind always presupposes and draws on the past and all its mental forms, derivatives, contents, and operations. For instance, cognition necessarily requires memory, which is the represented past, just as the mind itself requires certain ontic relations and neurobiological processes in order for there to be cognition at all. Similarly, the unconscious is lost presence, namely that which had formerly presented itself, albeit in its multiply derived forms, but had receded back into the abyss. Archaic primacy has a stipulated degree of causal influence over the driving force behind the dialectical psyche, since the archaic is always brought to bear upon presentational encounters that the subject confronts as immediacy, which furthermore stimulates projections of a future. The way the present is incorporated into the past, however, may be highly conditional and idiosyncratic, given the unique contingencies that comprise the nature of subjectivity, either individually or intersubjectively actualized. It is in this sense that the preservative aspect of mind may be very selective in what it retains. Although we may generally say that the past is preserved in some way, as our personal thrownness or developmental historicity, and this is certainly true of world history, there are certain elements that are, or have the potential of becoming, omitted or negated and forgotten altogether, hence denied, dissociated, and or repressed. That is, certain aspects of archaic primacy may not be operative, mobile, or causally expressive, and perhaps may fizzle out entirely in the psyche, while other aspects are selected, secured, harbored, and sustained, especially as segregated schemata within conscious life. A mediational presence is the subject's experience in the here and now, and how it engages what is presented before it, either as an internal event or stimulus, or as an external imposition, thus affecting thought, feeling states, somatic schemata, action, and their unconscious resonances. The immediacy of the lived encounter highlights the context and exigencies that influence the phenomenology of the emotional, cognitive, and unconscious aspects of personal experience. Although the present immediacy of the moment is largely a conscious phenomenon, immediate experience is always a mediated dynamic by virtue of the fact that archaic primacy already suffuses every lived encounter, which is superimposed as its facticity. This means that unconscious processes always saturate every conscious experience and become a mediatory screen or template in which the world is received and perceived, thus influencing the contingency and construction of experience. Selective retention is particularly operative within a mediational presence as cognition executes certain determinate choices in its relation to mediated experience. In effect, the psyche seizes upon certain aspects of its environment and or internally evoked stimuli from the press of archaic primacy, while refuting, denying access to, or limiting the range of others that may exert certain degrees of determinant influence on immediate experience. the range and signification of each mediated choice having resonance in the mind's trajectory and orientation toward the future. In every immediate encounter, the past and future are summoned and converge on the present. The archaic presupposes past form and content. The future superimposes goal-directed intentionality, immediate thought and action. Projective teleology is the future trajectory of a desired state of affairs, as fantasy, wish, intention, or purpose, that is stimulated by presentational processes or mediatory interventions, thus instigating the teleological projection of a goal-directed aim. Like archaic primacy and immediate experience, the projected future may entertain a certain selective aspect to the retention and or locus of experience that takes place within the transformative, progressive dialectical processing governing each mediated dynamic. Mediation stands in relation to which the subjective mind experiences as desire. This is fertile ground for shame to materialize. In all three spheres, however, there exists the primacy of ambiguity, uncertainty, and context. For real and virtual time may be suspended within the mind and experienced as radically dissociative, incongruent, and or atemporal, yet nevertheless wed to contingency. At any given moment of experience, the past and future are ontologically operative on subjective immediacy, bringing to presence the vast configurations and pressures of unconscious affect, wish, and defense, and the corresponding conscious reality that is simultaneously evoked and represented, such as the experience of trauma and shame. Archaic primacy, immediational presence, and projective teleology are functional aspects of orienting the psyche towards dialectical growth, even if regression and decay are activated consequences of the lived encounter. Here it becomes important to keep in mind that the psyche works radically to compress and transpose its multiple instantiations within its mediatory functions. There are multiple realities and self-states or micro-agents that coalesce, intermingle, compete, vie for attention and expression, and do battle for supremacy, enforcing themselves on the pressure cooker we call mind. The teleological motives of the dialectic are therefore informed by the threefold presence of the past, the present immediate context, and the future trajectory in which it is oriented, each vector exerting its own source and constraint on the inner constitution of the subject. The phenomena of awareness involves our immediate immersion in what we presently desire, feel, perceive, think, remember, emote, cognize, or otherwise experience as an internal temporal relation to intentional objects in fantasy or reality, mediated by unconscious agency. Just as Freud reminds us that the unconscious is timeless, the nature of consciousness as such is the outgrowth of an unconscious epigenetic instantiation and dialectical contrary that fractures its primordial cosmic eternity by introducing temporal enactments in and through qualitative experience, namely that which we live. And like the nature of experience itself, it is vast and variegated, punctuated by instances of particularity and its concomitant qualia. Here enters shame. Now that very dense introduction, I'm going to get into a case study. How do we make this work? Rachel came to see me after a referral from her family doctor. She was 47 years old, married with no children, unable to have a baby after her hysterectomy, with a 20-year history of depression and anxiety, primarily treated with Effexor, Wellbutrin, and Xanax for panic. She grew up in a strictly observing Irish Catholic home and suffered gross developmental traumas. Her father was described as a cruel man who would terrorize her and her siblings with threats of physical aggression, pounding his fists on the table during dinner, and would punish her if she showed any displays of emotion or anger. He was totalitarian, demanded unwavering conformity, and would discipline upon the slightest provocation or if his children did not do exactly what they were told. She recalls as a small child crying out at night from her room only to be beaten for waking up the house. She never cried out again. She used to rub her ankles together until they bled because she could not express her feelings openly and had to internalize everything. Rachel characterized her childhood as constantly living in fear and feeling unsafe, and made to feel responsible and guilty if her parents were upset. When she was six, she received a doll she wanted for her birthday and started to cry. Not because she was happy, she said, but because I didn't deserve it. Rachel's mother was described as cold, aloof, unavailable, and invalidating of her feelings and needs, such as when she told her mother she could not have children. Her reply was, you're free. She hated her mother growing up, as she was unnurturing and never gave her affection or hugs. And she sicked my father on me, she said, for upsetting her. In short, she never felt loved. Although her father did occasionally show affection during, quote, happy times, this stopped after she defied him in her teens, only to be shunned by him ever since. Rachel mentioned, almost in passing, that she and her husband, quote, never have sex, but reported that he was, quote, supportive. Upon this, she associated to how her father would follow her on dates, spy on her, and once assaulted her boyfriend on the street, accusing them of wanting to fornicate. But when she entered the covenant at the age of 20, her father wept and begged her to reconsider. She left shortly thereafter. All three of her siblings were distant and had cut ties from the family, only occasionally speaking to her. She described the onset of her depression and anxiety as the culmination of abuse, relational trauma, and the gradual withdrawal and withholding of acceptance and love, which she feared was becoming, quote, severe. At the end of the first session, she disclosed that I had instilled some hope as she found me kind. Rachel's father was raised in a strict religious home where weekly observance was mandatory for the family. During Rachel's upbringing, her parents always had priests and clergy over for dinner or after church functions, two of which were arrested for pedophilia. Charges that the parents dismissed, even though her father's, quote, best friend was convicted for molesting boys. As the initial sessions progressed, Rachel described her father acting like a, quote, jealous lover who controlled, dominated, and shamed her during her adolescence. She reported that all breakups with boyfriends were due to the father, and that he would make uncomfortable comments about her body and sex, and even removed the mirror in the bathroom because he accused her of looking at herself naked. Constant references were made about her weight and getting fat, and even her mother once accused her of seducing her father. She felt she was always the object of unjustified blame. At the beginning of the fourth session, my patient stated that she had felt an almost immediate lifting of her depressive symptoms that had brought her immense relief. Upon my query of what she thought was the reason for her sudden change in mood, she attributed this to me. Although I had sensed the development of an idealized transference, I was not prepared for what I was about to hear. I have a home office separated from other parts of the house with its own private entrance. As a matter of habit, I always greet my patients standing at my office door after hearing them enter the house and descend the stairs to my waiting area. This is when Rachel said that the first time she saw me, she had a vision of me as Jesus waiting for her. She said that she had immediately felt safe and that there would be no judgment of her, only a loving and accepting presence, which I embodied as her savior. She even asked if I had a beard when we first met, or if I had grown one since our last session. I've worn a beard since high school. Having been exalted to such a divine position, I immediately felt mortified and defensively wanted to laugh out loud. In fact, I recall blushing, hence feeling the blood rush to my face and having to keep it in, mindful not to appear shaming in any way, despite my own feeling of embarrassment. The comical thought of me being deified was about as ludicrous as I could imagine, let alone me allowing the delusion to persist. The immediate sense of shame was particularly intensified because, as you know, I've been an outspoken atheist most of my adult life, viewing the notion of God as no more than a supercilious idea. And to accept the transference projection would be a most profane form of inauthenticity and assault on the truth, as well as my sense of personal identity. In fact, as a general rule, I feel it's an ethical duty to challenge such social ideologies when confronted with the topic, but here I felt a curious reticence to remain silent and accept the idealization. Although adopting this posture I thought the patient required was for technical reasons and was warranted, even now I feel like I betrayed a personal sense of authenticity. When cast in perfectionistic fashions by patients in the course of therapy, I typically defer to the reality principle and suggest it's due to the transference or their need to see me in such romanticized ways, whereas a disidentification may be a more appropriate stance, or at least, at the very least, I would encourage a more holistic appraisal of integrating both good and less worthy aspects of my presence into some meaningful whole where fanciful fetishized elements are subsumed in more objective dimensions, albeit virtuous as they may seem to be. But here I felt paralyzed by Rachel's need to see me otherwise, and indeed felt it would be counterproductive not to adopt the therapeutic role responsiveness she was craving. Was this my countertransference? I'm still uncertain. But this question may itself be illegitimate, given that we can never entirely separate our personal psyches from the therapeutic encounter. Rather than dissuade such thinking on her part, I merely accepted the protagonist she needed me to be by not challenging her projection. Instead, I encouraged her to tell me more about her thoughts and feelings. After an outpouring of emotions, including feelings of loneliness, emptiness, and loss, Rachel felt like she was able to liberate her true inner experiences and talk about them for the first time, released from the childhood prison of her pathological accommodations. I made her feel safe, and my office felt like, quote, home, where she was allowed to have emotions and express them openly. She gradually admitted that she was not happy in her marriage after all, having come to realize that she picked a man who served as a compromise, representing or resembling both her parents. As she opened herself up to her inner world that previously remained compartmentalized and unformulated, she naturally felt a mourning for living a life that was unconsciously chosen, yet consciously denied. After only 10 sessions, her symptoms subsided and she went off all medication. This was also at the point her insurance benefits had been exhausted for the year, but she felt good enough that she did not need to return until the new year, when her plan resumed again. The new year came and passed, but she did not call to let me know. But she did call to let me know that she was doing fine and she did not need to return. Approximately 4 years later, she wrote me a letter to thank me for my help and to let me know that I was estranged, or that she was estranged from her parents, divorced, and was soon to remarry. Now, I consider this treatment to be a transference cure, where I offered very little in terms of being scantily more than an idealized self-object experience, providing transitional space via active listening, empathic attunement, and validation within a role-responsive holding environment intended to provide a corrective emotional ambience sensitive to her vulnerabilities and shame. Although there was some interpretive and integrative work that was accomplished, I am left with the humble conclusion that I was neither her savior nor a successful analyst, despite her suggestion otherwise. But I guess we all get lucky sometimes. You know, psychoanalysts of all persuasions and schools of thought often do not talk about or write openly and honestly about what they truly think and feel, or admit their internal conflicts or complexes, let alone what they actually do and say in the analytic session. This scholarly observation, I suggest, is largely due to shame and fear of exposure, critique, and ridicule by colleagues. And when analysts do speak freely about what transpired in the session, their experiences become alienated from their personhood and judged by others whether they like it or not, especially when technical principles, revealed content, and the specifics of interpretation and self-disclosure are ripe for intellectual rape. It is not uncommon to hear analysts from a particular psychoanalytic coterie or camp debasing or belittling analysts from different orientations when it comes to clinical praxis due to group identification, competition, and the narcissism of minor differences. But it is largely seen as exhibitionistic when therapists discuss their own personal traumas or tragedies in the professional literature, which is often invalidated, condemned, viewed as pathology or a countertransference enactment, or seen as a narcissistic act of self-expression inappropriate for the profession. You all, what I always remember in the thousands of books I've consumed in my lifetime is the classical analyst whose perfect interpretation was received. We never hear what really happened. It also takes courage to speak the truth, even if we risk verdicts and deprecation from others. whether this be about our own personal lives or what really transpires in the consulting room, not some manufactured narrative, contrived scenario, or massaged vignette that customarily permeates psychoanalytic writings, where the sage master demonstrates the perfect interpretation or intervention that all others should admire or aspire toward or emulate. In fact, this conventional practice is somewhat shameful, as it's disingenuous and inauthentic, for it never reveals the whole picture, as is typical of life. But we need to be honest with ourselves and with others. If we cannot disclose our personal feelings and conflicts with our fellow colleagues, then how can we advance as a profession? More analysts should be encouraged to be open and genuine when writing or speaking in professional space, because we may all learn from what they experience in their practices and struggle with internally. We need to be truthful and real if we are to progress as a discipline, and there is no shame in being human. We usually do not consider shame to be a philosophical matter, but rather a psychological state of mind we desperately seek to avoid. But shame may very well be one of the most salient emotions that ontologically structures subjectivity and contributes to group identifications and interrelations politicized within the social fabric of all cultures, hence informing the concrete universals reflective of collective humanity. Here we may say that shame is archetypal, a psychic dominant that is at once interiorized, externalized, and symbolic. Whether standing in relation to a set of ideals or values, the internalization of one's family, being a member of a group or nation state, or reveling in one's pension for a particular identification with a cherished object, the problematic of shame yields many philosophical representations. It further carries a modicum of humility amongst a backdrop of anxiety, for it is ubiquitous even when hidden. In fact, the ontic condition of hiddenness or concealment generates free-floating psychic unrest, as this reminds us of our intimate relation to time, which is ticking, by the way, and freedom, that which is chosen, enacted, and or denied. And here we generate time in the very act of consciousness as the coming into being of our lived subjectivity, the coming to presence and instantiation of our being. Shame is always lived in time, in living the embodied temporal, whether historical, immediate, or looming. And absurdly, we have no say in the matter whatsoever. Let's simply call this existential inertia, the impotence of freedom, for we just can't will away our emotions, only transform them. The temporal immediacy of our emotional lives is contingent upon the psychological realities that condition our experience of self, other, and world. As such, the past is unconsciously memorialized and becomes an eternal present from the standpoint of conscious reflection as recollection, while the future is an eternal recurrence of what came before through modified form. Both realms of psychic reality are united when the unconscious artifacts of personal history, as well as history in general, tearing within cultural memory, merge with the new now, the present of the present. Here, the presence of the present can retroactively alter the past as reinscription, which in turn can amend the contemporary, thus revealing the double character of their values, values that are internally divided. As in political economy, values vary over time. Nothing stays the same, although in their purest forms we have memorialization, presencing, and futurity, each supervening on one another as its own self-constituting form of emanationism. When futurity is realized, it becomes the actualization of the archaic, and when the past resurfaces in new patterns or appearances, it is the eternal recurrence of a new presence. There are no unchangeable states when it comes to the temporal, only perspectival shifts, except for the ontological merit that process is invariant and universal. It's itself an oxymoron, but something that can be always counted on. Or perhaps a better word is paradox, the aporia of impassable time. Does shame change, or is it re-emblazoned in the new now through temporal alterations and imprints on consciousness? I would surmise that the quality, intensity, and valence of shame does not qualitatively disappear in memory when revisited, as it is a traumatic, albeit subdued, reiteration, but it can be mitigated with time. History is never erased. Futurity is uncertain. All we have is now. This ultimately implies that temporality is the emotional instantiation of value.